I'm Anthony Donato. I'm the Transitional Year Residency Program Director. We take 6 transitional years every year, and we incorporate them into a larger internal medicine residency program that is 36 other residents that teach them and work alongside them. This is a very busy academic center, now a satellite hub for Drexel University Medical School, has a level 1 trauma center and one of the busiest ERs in the state of Pennsylvania, because it is one of the only hospitals in the area. It's a large catchment area, something close to about 250,000 people. But what's unique about us is we don't necessarily see the jobs of the residents as service. We see it as education. So they cover a small portion of the house where they can learn from patients, but they're not overwhelmed by the service aspects of it. Reading Hospital is the flagship hospital of a 6-hospital system that includes 5 smaller hospitals and a major pediatric hospital in Philadelphia we recently acquired, St. Christopher's. It's a beautiful, relatively new and constantly upgraded hospital system. So you will get patients from some of these smaller facilities that can't handle some of the higher acuity or need specialty care that will be transferred in. So it's more chances to see interesting patients. But your training as a transitional year will happen only here. So there's no commute or having to live elsewhere. You're here and you're here for your year. So I'd like you in a year to really give some deeper thoughts to where your career is going. You're not going to have a ton of service requirements. In fact, you're going to have 5 to 6 months of electives where you can figure out more about what you've got to get better at. So if you're heading into ophthalmology, for instance, you can do ocular pathology, you can work with a plastic surgeon, you can see a lot of things that you might not otherwise see, even in your fellowship, to brush up on. When you're on the busiest service that you're on, you're off 1 day in 7 all the time. You don't pull 24-hour call. We do have a night float system, which is slightly more onerous because you work multiple nights in a row, but it's 2 weeks for the entire year and not more than that. So the toughest of the rotations are not nearly as onerous as things used to be, because we want you to learn in an environment that you can be able to take breaks, rejuvenate, and come back. Doctors see their patients for 30 minutes to an hour in a day. Nurses see them the other 23 hours. So you want good eyes on people, and they are outstanding. On a given inpatient service, you would start your day around 7 o'clock. Because the transitional years are new, you would actually have an intern morning report with only the people that are also new. And we would go over what happened the night before. Anything from "I got paged about" to "this happened to me when I was called to see this patient," and we would learn as a collective for the first 30 minutes. What happened? What can we learn from it? So that everyone can learn from the common experience. From there then, we would actually meet the night float team, and we would hear about what came in the night before, we would assign the patients, and we would make a plan for the entire day for who's going home, who's sick, and we would decide who we would actually go walk around on that very morning, because the sickest or patients that have something unstable overnight, we will go see as a team. Generally at 11 o'clock, if we're on call, we talk about what happened, what's new, and then we would admit in the afternoon, anywhere from 1 to, if you're on call, approximately 8 o'clock at night, you'd admit, and that would be every fourth night. If we were post-call, we would actually meet back after our work was done, sometimes 4 or 5 o'clock, talk about what is still outstanding in terms of work, and in those settings, we would sit down and go over what we can learn globally about what happened. We would have a version of teaching rounds. About 10 years ago, we became interested in using portfolios for growth and mentoring. So the idea behind having a portfolio is to essentially build a canvas of discussion between you and your mentor, so that that discussion is generally more useful to your own growth, rather than I just sit here and ask you how your day was and whether you filled out this this and this form. I can talk about where are you going in your career, how are you doing as a teacher, how are you doing professionally, what feedback are you getting and how are you responding to that, what's burning you out. And I can look as a mentor and say, here's where I need to work with this person specifically to help them. And I think the portfolio helps me understand where they're going, where they're growing. There's a Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And I make the case that if your needs are not met at the bottom, the very top is actually learning. So you've got to be safe. You've got to have enough money to be able to take care of yourself, take care of your spouse. You'd like to have a safe environment to live in, to work in. You've got to be fed. These kind of things we take care of. There's free parking. You have places to put your stuff. You have cheap places to live. And yeah, you are 5 minutes from a trail to bike. You are 1 minute from a trail to hike. It's nice. There's good schools. There's a safe environment. And there's people that enjoy teaching here. So I think it's a great opportunity to grow and prosper in your career. The residents that come here, we feel very vested in watching them grow. We keep long-lasting relationships with them long after they go. Our ultimate goal is we want them to come back. We want to fill Reading Hospital with the best and brightest to come back and serve the patients of Berks County. You're a transitional year. You can pretty much go anywhere. People choose here because of the flexibility, because of the personal interest in your growth, because of the learning over service, and the ability to really grow into the doctor you want to be.